coming from New Zealand, it's not that often we get the chance to get up close and personal with a genuine Group C race car. However, behind me is a 1989 Sauber Mercedes C9. Now, the C9, not this particular chassis behind me, but the C9 won Le Mans back in 1989. And we're here with David from EPS Motorsport to talk a little bit about the restoration of this car, and in particular, the electronics. So, David, particularly when you're dealing with a very high-value car such as this, the restoration has to be taken pretty carefully. How do you balance the sort of modern technology we've got access to now with keeping the car genuine and in the sort of spirit of the 1989 car that it was?
Yeah, I mean, that's always the hardest balance, isn't it? You've got to use the electronics to your advantage nowadays. So all the modern, like, oil pressure cuts, temperature cuts, you know, bits and pieces, closed loop wideband lambda, you know, these are all things that probably weren't as good as they were, you know, back in the day. So we've sort of come a long way since, you know, 89. So, you know, injectors, a few bits and pieces were sort of allowed to upgrade and change. And, you know, that's kind of what we've done with this car, really. We've sort of swapped out the original Bosch Motronic ECU, CNC scanned the original, machined another one, and then filled it full of MoTeC goodies. So
there's a whole lot of stuff that you've just said there which I want to go back and unpack, but just because you've finished up there on that Bosch Motronic ECU, and I think that's just a sign of how far our technology has come. It only takes a quick look at the size of that old ECU case sitting there on the left-hand side of the bulkhead, and you compare that to a modern ECU, it's pretty clear to see how far we've come. Now, because you've started talking about that, what have you done there? You've kept the look of it because it's original on the outside, but tell us what's on the inside.
Yeah, on the inside, the original Bosch ECU, that carried out the control of the electronic boost control, the ignition side of things, and also the rest of the car's fuel injection system. So injectors, water temp, air temp, you know, all the normal sort of throttle position, etc. So what we've basically done is removed all that, and then we'll put some turbo smart boost control valves in there, MoTeC CDI, MoTeC M800, and then that also, you know, that's got onboard logging in itself, full wideband lambda control, closed loop boost control, all the standard modern stuff, really.
All the stuff that wasn't available back in 1989. But the nice part about it is, aesthetically, it still looks identical, including the Autosport connectors on the top of the Bosch Motronic box. So is that wiring harness to the rest of the car still the original, or has that been remanufactured as well?
No, it's been remanufactured, still with, like, period connectors, just to keep that period look. And then we just use, like, the modern ray cam and DR, you know, sort of wire and bits and pieces, just to make it modern, because 89 is a long time ago, and, you know, like, wiring in a race car can only lose your races, never win your races. So, you know, you've got to make sure that everything's in really good condition, really. So, yeah.
Now, one of the things you've mentioned there with the boost control inside of the ECU case, and now that is definitely not something we see these days. In particular, the first concern I've got is you're running a very long line to the ECU from the wastegates and from the boost pressure source. Does that present any issues for boost control compared to placing that three-port solenoid closer to the wastegate itself?
I mean, you naturally get a delay because you've got, you know, boost control valves to fill hoses and also fill wastegates. But you got to remember, like, this sort of car, there's not a lot of engines and parts around. So if you sort of hit the gas and the boost isn't there instantly, the reduced torque is probably going to increase its life a little bit as well. And you know, on a dyno, this thing sort of does, like, sort of 700-ish sort of foot-pounds of torque. So sometimes 550, 600 foot-pounds of torque when you initially hit it is not a bad thing, you know.
Actually, in talking about that, we haven't really mentioned the engine, and it is a 5-litre V8, but it's a special block from what I understand as well, just making it that little bit trickier if you do have a failure to source parts. Can you tell us what it is actually based on?
I mean, Mercedes sort of developed themselves, really. They sort of took the original road car block, and then it was, like, recasted and strengthened, and when we went to make this car, like, we found that we couldn't actually use one, really. We had to, like, make sure that we used the motorsport block to just, you know, that way the casting and stuff's, you know, nice and thick and solid and in the areas. And also the heads, the water cooling and the intake manifold, it flows water through the intake manifold, and it's really, really crazy. And even with modern, like, 5XS CNC machines, the machinists, like, he couldn't believe what these guys machined back in 89.
And again, basically the technology back then for machining was nowhere near what we've got now.
No, that's right. And he had to buy special tooling and piss about, and, you know, like, and yeah, it's they were quite well ahead of their time, really, Mercedes.
And when you're dealing with an engine like that, where getting hold of a replacement block, if there is a failure, is borderline an impossibility, again, given the value of the car and its historic nature. How does that play into your mind when you're sitting on the dyno mapping it?
Yeah, you gotta definitely not drink the night before. We've got, you know, a good dyno, and it's all built by X-Tech Engineering, and they do a fabulous job, and we've got a good running procedure, and, you know, but we are quite careful with mapping it and stuff, you know, like, certainly could probably get a bit more power out of it and whatever, but it's not really always about that with cars like this, you know. So, and you know, don't get me wrong, like, the power level it's got is still enough to keep everybody interested. So, yeah.
Can we learn what it is making power-wise? You mentioned the torque figure, but yeah, what's the power?
It's about 800-ish, you know, sort of low 800s, yeah.
And what sort of boost are you using to achieve that number?
We actually use really low boost. It's actually 0.9 of a bar.
When you've got 5 litres of displacement, though, you're not going to need a huge amount of boost pressure to help you on your way. What fuel does it run on?
It runs on a TC fuel, and that's like a turbo fuel that we can get from Sunoco. So
a specialised turbo fuel with a high octane. So in that case, am I safe to assume at that sort of 0.7 bar boost knock, not really a huge concern?
Not an issue at all, no. We keep it, like, you know, we take it up to knock so we can sort of hear where it is, so we can sort of characterise ignition graphs. And then sort of make sure that we're like about sort of about 1.5 degrees away from that. And then because of the reliability of the fuel, you know, we can get away with running that all the time. So,
yeah. While the 100 series ECU from MoTeC that you are running in this doesn't have the onboard knock control, it was an option. Is that something you've used here, or is it just not necessary?
Just not necessary, yeah. Yeah, we haven't actually got it on this car, yeah.
Just wanted to talk a little bit about that, the turbo setup on it. And again, this is an area we've seen absolutely night and day changes between the technology and 89, what we've got now. I know that it looks like it's still running fairly period correct turbo and wastegate setup. Can you tell us about what's fitted to it?
Yeah, I mean, they look period correct from the outside, but what's inside them is modern stuff. So, you know, we take apart a modern wastegate, and then we sort of use all the internals, and then we use all the original castings, and then we sort of put it back. So that way, when you look in the engine bay, it sort of looks correct, and then, you know, you've got modern internals inside it, really. And you know, the wastegates that are here, you know, you've got an outer chamber that looks quite large in modern terms. And it is, but certainly it's not that large on the inside. So
that makes a lot of sense. Can you talk us through also the fuel system there? I noticed that you are running 2 injectors per cylinder. What size injectors are fitted to it?
They're 2 as-new performance injectors, and they're 450cc.
Now, are you running those in a staged fashion?
No, they're both on at the same time.
Not necessary due to the size of them?
No, not necessary, yeah. It's just easy with the 100 series as well to just pair them and away you go.
Now, in terms of that, if you're only talking 880cc's per cylinder, that's not really a big injector by today's standards. Would you be able to go to just a single injector, or is that just due to the design of the manifold?
It 100% was the design of the manifold. That's back in the day. Mercedes had the twin injector, and they sort of done it with, you know, because back in the day, these things were running for 24 hours, and fuel efficiency was a big, big, you know, issue. So, you know, obviously the more atomized the fuel, and more of it than, you know, shared through 2 injectors, you could potentially get, you know, performance gains by sort of trying to optimize the spray pattern from the injectors, etc. So that was their theory back then, really. And that's kind of what we sort of carry on now, really. So,
Yeah, well, certainly when you're looking at a 24-hour race, the fuel efficiency is a big thing with pit stop strategy as well. So anything you can do to gain an economy advantage there is worthwhile. And in terms of the rest of the electronics package, again, when you look into the cabin there, looks relatively period correct. We haven't got any large digital displays for the driver or anything like that. However, you did mention that you are still using some modern logging. Can you talk us through that?
Yeah, sure. Underneath the actual dashboard in the front there, we've got a L120 logger from MoTeC. And that just allows us the extra capacity to run the vehicle, like, and analyze the whole data from the whole, like, these sort of run in, like, 45, 50-minute races, you see. So the 100 series hasn't got enough capacity to do that on its own. Also, what we've got is we've got brake pressure front rear, clutch pressure, to make sure that drivers haven't got bad habits, resting foot on clutches, stuff like that. And then we also, you know, we put GPS speed and we could do track mapping and stuff like that. And this car will also have a camera system linked to that as well. So we could then sort of like use that for the driver to, you know, he can sort of look at where his track position and, you know, sort of driver performance related stuff really.
Looking at ways to improve the chassis as well as the driver based on that modern technology. You have still got some driver displays available there. Can you talk us through what's there?
Yeah, sure. We've got the original RPM. You know, sort of unit. We've got an old MoTeC MDD, which we've sort of integrated into it, and that's black and white, so it keeps period to the car really. That's the main reason that we sort of use it. But also we've got on it, we've got the shift light module, so that does, you know, obviously all the RPM stuff, and integrated into the warning alarm system. So a
few hints to modern technology, correct, but not taking away from the period correctness. And the other thing as well, if you were building a car of this nature today, relays and fuses or circuit breakers definitely wouldn't be a thing. We'd be going straight for a power distribution module. Have you folded there and gone with one of those, or is it still original?
No, we're still original, just with new fuses and relays. And
let's be honest, it was good enough to win a 24-hour race, so probably good enough to get up the driveway here at Goodwood. Look, today you're actually racing the car yourself, David, so we wish you all the best and have a great weekend.
Thank you very much. If you don't see me again, yeah.
We'll it didn't go well.
Yeah, of course.
Cheers.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.